now
on 105.9 FM and streaming worldwide on the WMAL app.
O'Connor and Company.
8:06 on America's Morning Show. O'Connor and Company coming to you from Washington, the District of Columbia. Wherever you're listening, thanks for joining us. Coming up in 30 minutes, Emily Miller on the manslaughter case against Alec Baldwin. It's now in the courtroom, and she'll give us a firsthand account of what that's looking like. I'm Larry O'Connor. She's Patrice Onwuka. Good morning, Patrice.
Good morning. Happy Friday.
I love my staff, but they add things. They add things all the time. Very end. I'm catching hell from my wife for that. Anyway.
Honestly, quite possibly the most relatable thing Joe Biden said about catching hell from one's wife.
Oh,
joining
boy.
Us now, Sean Spicer, former White House press secretary, host, of course, of the mighty Sean Spicer Show that you can see on literally every platform, including the First TV. I would check it out on YouTube. In fact, both Patrice and I appeared on his show earlier this week.
Earlier this week,
it's only right for us to return the favor. Sean, would you even consider that? Well, actually, we'll get to that in a minute. Let me ask you first. First, good morning. How are you, Sean?
Good morning, guys. I'm a
genius. Oh, no. Sean Spicer has a cold.
No.
I'm just doing that. I'm doing my Joe Biden impression.
Yes.
No,
I understand. I know how much you love it when a politician immediately starts blaming his staff like that on a public stage. What did you make of that moment there?
Well, I think it was payback. I mean, those guys, there's a 3-day NATO summit, and they're like, how about a 6:30 press conference? And I had a lot of people that were like,
you're sort of sympathetic.
Like, the guy tells him, I need to go to bed earlier. Like, what if we push it back to 6:30? How do you think that is? 3 days in NATO, and then we do that. And oh, by the way, your entire political future hangs in the balance. Anything you want to do before that, by the way, maybe we could get a workout in. I was like, dude, if you're the staff, you literally just sort of were just like, hey, what else can we throw at this guy to try to see if he can screw up? Oh, let's throw in a Lester Holt interview on Monday, just in case that's not enough. I mean, look, I don't like to blame staff as a former staffer, but my God, those guys set him up. I had a lot of people who are like, I'm not a conspiracy theorist, but do you think they're trying to push him out of the race? I was like,
oh,
I don't
man.
Know. I look.
Well,
that,
Sean, Sean, we were on your show on Monday, and you asked us whether we thought that he would last by through the end of the RNC next week, and both Larry and I said no. I think we've reassessed based on last night, and we actually think that Biden bought himself some more time. What do you think? Do you think last night was enough to stop Nancy Pelosi and Obama from giving him the hook?
Well, so the thing about, and you know this, Patrice, I mean, it's not, they can't give him the hook. He owns those delegates. Trump actually said it very well the other night. Like, they're his delegates. He would have to voluntarily step aside. And what I saw last night is a guy that has his heels dug in. I think there's a couple factors at play. Obama is probably the worst messenger on this because there is a huge chip on Biden's shoulders from the way he was treated in 2016 and shoved out of the way for Hillary Clinton. He wants respect from these folks. He thinks, as he said last night, I'm the guy who beat Trump. I'm going to do it again. I think the only person that really probably could affect him on a personal level is Jill, maybe his sister Valerie. But then I also think that, like, the top staff, the Mike Donilon, Bruce Reed, Steve Ricchetti, I just don't think they're willing to give up power. And that's – look, everyone in the DMV gets – power, right? Whether you're an administrator or a staffer running some agency or a congressional health staffer, you get the notion of power in D.C. And therefore, all these people around him have no incentive to give that up. So I think that being said, what I saw last night was a man that's determined. And he made a couple flubs, obviously. Although I do want to say this, and I don't think this is getting any attention, which is why I wanted to bring it to your audience. There's a new theory out there, which I'm willing to look into today, which is that Trump advocates for the 25th Amendment. And as you know, he's his vice president. So then Biden goes out of the way and Trump ascends to the presidency right away. I think this is I want to look into this a little bit more. But I think that, you know, the beauty is that now as his vice president, the race just totally changed because you can say, get the cabinet to call it. Then oh, Trump ascends to the presidency, and he saves all this money on the campaign. I think, and the funny thing is, I mean, who knows? Maybe he picks Harris as his vice president. And
it's right up there with Tulsi. I think we're actually getting a glimpse into the bizarre world of Sean Anon, where these conspiracy theories are floated on a regular basis. Trust the plan, Sean. Just on the pure, you know, definite, because we're going to keep hearing, wow, what a press conference. Would you even call that a press conference? He had pre-approved reporters who had already been screened by comms. He only asked those reporters that had been listed. He didn't stand there and allow all the reporters to ask whatever they wanted. And I didn't see any questions that pertain to some of the things that are actually sort of burning issues, like no cabinet meetings for 9 months, the Parkinson's specialist. How can you not ask a question about the Parkinson's guy?
It's actually, it's interesting that you bring this up, because logistically there's a lot, there's a lot that went into this in terms of it where it was, right? So it wasn't in the White House briefing room, meaning the access is a totally different issue, because you can't just walk in there if you have a hard pass. And you're right. I mean, I thought, again, this is very inside the weeds, but Politico reported that it was Anita Dunn, not Corinne Jean-Pierre, that came up with the list of reporters. That wasn't exactly a vote of confidence for your press secretary. Look, I'm less bothered. Look, I would give the – just so people give the context. When you are holding a press conference with the president that day, the press staff's job is to say, okay, this is who's going to be in the room. This is what our suggestion is. So I would normally give a list to President Trump, and he'd look at me and say, shut up, get out. And then he would ignore the list. Because I don't think he cared. And so I'm not as shocked. I mean, frankly, not normally with Biden, but the tradition is always that the staff will give a list to the president. That's not shocking to me. I actually thought it was a little weird the way he was, I have this list. Yeah. It's sort of like telling people the magic trick. Like, I'm now going to put this ball in the pocket, and I'm going to pull it out from behind my hand. And you're like, dude, you're ruining the magic. That to me, it's like he always sort of says what the magician is doing the trick. And you're like, wow, that's an optical illusion there, sleight of hand or whatever. And Biden's always just like, so I'm just going to pull this quarter from behind my thumb. It was sitting there the whole time. You're like, okay, the illusion's gone, brother.
Well, Sean, but to pick up on that, so we have reporting now that in two separate other interviews, Biden either the interviewers were either fed the questions directly from the campaign, or the campaign went back and asked for the interview to be edited and edited in a way that would help President Biden. I actually wonder if the questions asked last night were pre-approved, perhaps even pre-written by the White House. Is that another conspiracy theory?
I think it is. Yeah, it definitely is a conspiracy theory. I will tell you this, based on my experience and the questions that were asked, I don't think so. I mean, if they had been asked, they would be much more along the lines of the radio one. But the point, Patrice, that I think is worth noting is in two of the cases now, we do know that they were compliant, right? And the bigger issue that I think is there's an overarching issue, which is the compliance of the media. So in the case of these radio interviews that the president did, we know that they gave them 8 questions and said, you get to choose 4, tell us which 4 you're choosing. Mm-hmm. And they all agreed to that. But the bigger issue with the media is they all have known about this mental issue and concerns that senior staff and others have had, and yet they haven't reported on it, right? So the CNNs, the Politicos, the Washington Post, the New York Times, et cetera. And here's the choice that exists. Either they knew about it and were complicit in covering it up, right? So the New York Times and all these people had literally, I think, were well aware of all these issues and chose not to cover it. In fact, gaslit anybody who brought it up. And if you say to me, Sean, I don't think that's true, they'd never do that. Okay, then they suck at reporting. You can't say that one of the two has to be true. Either you suck at doing your job because you never saw this and you claim that you have all these sources that never told you something that George Clooney was like, yeah, it was apparent at the press, at the event that you guys were at that we held in L.A. Everyone's now coming out of the woodwork about all these events. So either CNN and the New York Times and everything are really bad at reporting and never saw what everybody says everybody saw for the last several months, or you guys were complicit in covering it up. And that's, to me, the bigger issue right here.
I agree.
Is that with President Trump, it was like, there's a guy who just watched an Instagram video on psychology who thinks that he's unfit for office, and we want to get the panel's reaction. And then with these guys, they're like, don't you dare bring something up.
Mm. Yeah. Hey, Sean, can you stay with us for one more segment? Because there's some other aspects of your vast knowledge and expertise that we'd like to draw upon.
Yeah, I will tell you, staying inside the Hadid Carpet Cleaning Center, unless I can get garagedoorrepair.com to open this thing up, it's a little stuffy in here right now.
Right.
You guys, I mean, so I can do it, but it's just, I mean,
I understand.
I'm going to talk to Ben.
We have many other laudable air conditioning people that we could send your way as well. I don't want to name one over the other because there's plenty of them, but you nailed two of the important names that we like to mention. In fact, speaking of the Hadid Carpet Cleaning Traffic Center, here is Jamie Whitt.
Sean, I'm breathing okay, so I'm going to open a couple windows for you. How's that? Let's get this going. We want Sean to stay. All right, 395.
Weeknights with Mark Levin, 6 to 9 p.m.
on News Talk 105.9 WMAL, making sense of the news.
We continue with Sean Spicer, who is not only a fantastic host of his show, The Sean Spicer Show, which you can get on, and you can also get the audio-only track on Apple or Spotify or wherever you like your podcast. And not only is he a former White House press secretary, but he also was one of the chief political and communications operatives at the Republican National Committee, whereupon he was responsible for two Republican National Conventions, 2012 as well as 2016, which means you're probably going through some PTSD right now, knowing this is the weekend before the convention in Milwaukee. What do you make of how the plans are shaping up right now or what we've learned of them?
I actually enjoy being able to sit back now and watch it as opposed to having to live it. I think they're doing a great job in Milwaukee. I love how this is coming together. I think the way that Trump has instituted gotten himself involved in the platform to make it more, this is what it's supposed to be. I mean, I hate to say this. It's a much better document right now. I would have loved the pro-life language to be a little bit stronger to me personally, but you know, you don't get everything you want in a platform. I like how it's being orchestrated. Look, at the end of the day, this is a show. We're highlighting our candidates, our policies to not just the country, but to the world. And I think that it's going to look fantastic. I like some of the speakers that they've put forward so far. It looks less stuffy. I mean, this is where Trump really shines is as the showman, because he understands the optics of what people are seeing. And it looks less like a Washington-produced show than a New York, L.A. And that's what I think he really brings to the table. And trust me when I tell you, he's personally involved in all this.
So to pick up on that thread then, Sean, can we expect that the VP candidate who will be announced, it's going to be apprentice style. Larry and I were fantasizing about this morning, that it's going to be, you know, Don Jr. is going to really just introduce everyone. The stage is going to be reset. You're going to see the big conference room table. Ivanka will come out. And then you're going to have like the row of contestants, the big names we've known, and maybe even one or two dark horses come out. And then he's going to decide apprentice style. Are we way off or I mean, do you see that happening?
I talked about that on the show yesterday. I thought that would be great. Marco, your interview with Kristen Welker, really strong. Doug Burgum, I love the way you responded to Margaret Brennan, strong on that. JD Vance, holding your own with Dana Bash, amazing. And then, you know, I think that would be so unbelievable. I mean, it would be embarrassing for the people who didn't get chosen, but I will tell you, that would be great. And you eliminate them one by one. Although, on the show yesterday, I threw that idea out there, and I think it was Chris DeGaulle, Larry, who said, what if instead, bachelor style, they give them an American flag? They're like, everyone kind of...
Instead of a rose?
Like, you know, of a rose. You know, I thought, okay, that's a little tweak. And I'm sure there's some kind of intellectual property issue with The Apprentice. And so I don't know. Maybe that kind of does what you need to do. But anyway, I think that you're going to get an answer Sunday. Anyway.
Sunday. I was going to ask you, when do you think it's going to be? You know, 8 years ago, it would have been this day, Friday. He took to Twitter and announced it would be Pence. And then they had an appearance on Saturday. You think it's going to be Sunday? And do you have an idea of who it might be?
I do. So first of all, I would just say this, knowing it's not easy to just make that happen. So I don't know that they can change, but my guess yesterday was that if this press conference had gone really bad, they would bleed that, let him bleed it out. I think that because it was a push, yes, he screwed up Putin. Yes, he screwed up Trump and called him his vice president. But I don't think that changes the dynamic time.
What a low bar we have these days.
I know. although Putin's like, should I call Trump now that he's vice president? I don't know. I will just say that I think the first person has a name that's two letters.
Has two letters?
Yeah.
You think
only two letters? Oh, JD.
Well,
JD Vance.
That's where.
Yeah.
If I were putting money down, and I'm not saying I put $4,000 this morning down, but I mean, if I did, that's
what. Do you think it's because of Don Jr. is going to be introducing the running mate? Do you think that was that the last clue for you?
I would say that. I mean, I thought that was where the money would go the last little while.
Okay.
I also think that we could be getting at, like, it's Trump, and I think that I think Marco Rubio has done an amazing job articulating the policies of this president and the America First agenda the last several months. Like, watching him on TV is a masterclass. I think Burgum would bring some serious chops as a businessman. So I don't have a problem with any of them, and I know, knowing Trump, I do think that there's always that, like, attempt to throw a wrench in the stuff so that you keep everybody guessing. But I love all of them. I literally will not be disappointed with any pick that's been floated by them. That doesn't mean any name. It means any name that the Trump campaign has admitted as being vetted is good with me.
Got it. All right, Sean Spicer, thanks again,
always,
my friend. And thanks for, you weren't...
All right,
you
Lisa,
yeah, thanks for having us on, too.
No, and thanks, you weren't gratuitously mean to me, so I appreciate that.
that's the thing, is because I'm stuck in the Hadid Carpet Cleaning Center until the guys from GarageDoorRepair.com
correct.
Opened the thing. I knew I was trapped, and this was your new ploy, but I appreciate... Jamie Whitten put out an entire little crudité spread that's amazing. I want to thank you guys for your hospitality. You really stepped it up a bunch.
You bet. And by the way, thank you for all of the great, entertaining, big boy press conferences you conducted over your career. Although, honestly, were they really that big? Honestly,
mine were bigger. Just so you know, I know audience. Well,